Anyone here in the back? Yeah? So, Alan Cooper opened this morning by telling us about this this phrase which I had never heard before, Keynote. And I wrote it down. He said it means letting go of what you cherish, to open the way to something of greater value. And Shweta emailed me about a day and a half ago, and she said, "Emergency, we have lost our venue." And I thought, oh my gosh, you know, I've organized events in the past, and that's like my worst nightmare. It's like lose the venue 48 hours prior to the event. And here we are in this fabulous venue. Right? So I am sure that they went through a lot of stress, but I also know that the team has put in a tremendous amount of work, and they lost something they cherished. And we have had something very valuable here today. So I think they deserve a hand of applause. The tremendous amount of work that's going on in the buildings. And also the sponsors for having us here. Thank you. And of course, thank you all, because it's a Saturday, and it's a long weekend, and yet you have spent the day with us talking about information architecture. It was only a year ago that we last met at World IA. And I say it like that because to me it feels like a much longer time period has passed. It feels like a very different world today. In the video that we saw earlier, Richard Saul Wurman talked about the needs of the age and our discipline as being one that responds to the needs of the age. And I am here today speaking to you about the sense of urgency and concern about the state of the world that we're living in, and major transformations that I see happening, which are coming upon us very quickly. The world is changing around us, and we need to come to the realization that as designers, we not only have agency over what is happening in the world, we also have responsibility about what is happening. So that is what this presentation is about. Light stuff, right? To close up the day. And I'm going to start, as I often do, by talking about architecture. I studied architecture. My background is in architecture. I see the world through an architect's eyes. And when I was studying to become an architect, I had the great privilege of being able to spend 2 semesters in Rome, Italy, studying Italian culture, the Italian language, and architecture. And one of the things that architects learn when they spend any amount of time in Rome is that buildings can last a long time. And I got to see a lot of buildings in the city, very beautiful spaces during my time there. There was one in particular that stood out for me, and it was this one. This is the Basilica of San Clemente a Laterano. It's a beautiful medieval church. But Rome is full of beautiful medieval churches. So why did this one stick in my mind? The reason is that the Basilica is built on top of the site of an earlier place of worship, which was used by the early Christians as a place where they would have their masses. And you can visit this earlier place of worship by going to a basement. And it's fascinating because in the basilica, where you in a normal church, you find all this iconography that we can relate to because we crosses and stuff, that's what we associate with Christianity. When you go to the basement, you see that these people use a very different set of symbols. They use the fish instead of the cross as a primary reference for the thing. But the story doesn't stop there. It turns out that that early Christian church was built on top of an earlier place of worship that was used by followers of the cult of Mithra. And you can visit this as well. There is a basement underneath the basement. And you can stand in that space and get a tangible sense for the evolution of Western spiritual practice just by being there. It's an astonishing place to begin. So it's important for us to recognize that buildings serve more than utilitarian. They don't just keep us out of the rain. right? They tell stories about who we are. In a way, they're physical articulations of our political, social, cultural, and economic structures. Our environments articulate who we are as a people, and they define us as a people. And I think about this a lot, you know, this contrast between architecture, which produces these incredibly durable and significant artifacts, and software, which is what I currently design, right? Because if architecture makes these things that last a long time, software is among the most ephemeral things that we design. Those of you who use iPhones may recall that a few years back, Apple released iOS 7, and the 7th version of the OS introduces completely new visual language, and from one day to the next, it was really interesting what happened. Like, I had all these apps on my phone, and I installed this update, and all of a sudden, these perfectly functional apps looked really old. And man, what happened? These people are not on it, you know? It's like, these apps used to be so cool yesterday, and now they suck. I'm really old. And it's important for us to recognize that this incredibly fast change, this malleability, is an essential characteristic of what we work on. Unlike building materials, such as brick, wood, and steel, software is malleable, it's reproducible, it's iterative, so it's, you know, we can iterate on it a lot, it's ubiquitous, right? And as a result of all these characteristics, it's getting faster, cheaper, more functional, more pervasive all the time. And as a result of this, software is eating the world. This is a memorable phrase by Mark Andreessen, who is an early web entrepreneur and now a venture capitalist. And those of you who are my age, perhaps a bit younger even, or a bit older as well, may recall that music, if you wanted to buy music, you used to have to go to stores like this. And somewhere in there is an ABBA album. With. But I don't get my music like this anymore, right? I now stream music to my phone. So the business of selling records in a physical place has been eaten by software. That's a business phrase, right? But you would say, well, okay, that's all right, because music is information. Music is the sort of thing that you can sell online, that you can consume online, so you know, that is then. We are safe, you know, our industry is not going to be disrupted like this. But it turns out that even industries that completely depend on physical location, like, for example, an ice cream shop, are being transformed by information and by software, because we are in the process of applying this layer of information and metadata on all the world. And Kate talked about these three orders of information. I don't have to belabor the point, right? Now, it's important to recognize that software doesn't just disrupt existing industries, right? It also makes possible things that were previously impossible. So, last year I had the opportunity to participate in EuroI, and that was in Amsterdam. And I was able to navigate the city and to do things like get on the right subway car and order lunch, even though I don't speak Dutch, because I have this app on my phone that I can hold up to the environment and it translates text in real time, right? And Karina was talking this morning about similar augmented reality applications that do something to the environment, that changes it and changes our relationship. Karina talked about these breakfast boxes and pointing the phone at it, and all of a sudden you have this different dimension. And after that happens, the kitchen table is no longer the same sort of place it was before. I think it's important for us to recognize that. The things that we are designing, we who work in information, are changing our understanding of the world around us. There's this quote I love by the designer and writer Edward Rosberg. He said, "The skill of writing is creating a context in which other people can think. And I think in this quote, and modified it a little bit to talk about what we do, I think that the skill of designing is creating contexts in which other people can work, learn, play, organize, shop, bank, find an ice cream shop, plan their 60th birthday party, right? In the video that Kate showed, Nick Bolt compared what we do to architecture somehow and used it as a metaphor. Well, I increasingly think that it is not a metaphor. Salesforce is not the tool people use to do their work. Salesforce is where the work happens. It's a sort of place. I find this idea that we're making these contexts incredibly powerful and frankly intoxicating, because it means that we have great agency in the way that people understand it. The thing I'm concerned about is that oftentimes I speak with designers, people who are organizations doing the sort of thing that we do, and I ask them, well, what are you working on? And they'll usually say something like, oh, I'm working on this particular app. Or I'm working, in some cases, I'm working on this particular feature of an app. Or I'm working on a screen, or I'm working on an icon, or whatever. But it seems like our focus is oftentimes much too narrow. And we're kind of at risk of missing the forest for the trees. So what do I see the forest as? To me, it's of great interest, this tension that exists between these incredibly ephemeral things that we're making, and the fact that we are complementing and in some cases replacing incredibly long-lived environments that we have been kind of taking for granted for a long time. I think that if we are to build our societies upon software, it is not unreasonable for us to expect some kind of contextual stability in those environments. Richard Solomon set me up for this, but in his presentation he talked about asking questions. And David, I don't know where David is, but David talked about the importance of asking questions as well. So I will tell you what the question I'm concerned with right now is. And this is a question that informs this presentation. The question is, how can you design information environments that support wholeness in the long term? And the key word here, and perhaps the most obvious one, is wholeness. And what I mean by wholeness is, I mean it in the sense that the architect Christopher Alexander does. And before using the word wholeness, he had this phrase, he said, the quality of the thing. And there's a little other phrase that he uses which can serve as a proxy here, which is a good fit between a context and a form that was designed to address that context. So there's this aspect of something being good, with a capital G. Okay? So how can we design information environments that support wholeness in the long term? So you all are sitting there in the audience, and we've heard a bunch of really fascinating and encouraging presentations this morning. And if I were sitting on your side, room here, I would be asking myself, so why is he talking about this stuff? Why should I care? After all, I think that design is now successful. Like, we are acknowledged as an important part of business, especially here in this part of the world. I think that people understand that if you're to develop a new product or service, it behooves you to have it be well defined and designed. We have made the cover of the Harvard Business Review people. This is, we are now part of the structure, the fabric of this. So why should we care? And I think we should care because we and our kids have to live in the world that we're creating. And I'm not entirely convinced that the information environments that we're designing are leading us to a viable world. I am starting to perceive signals around me that things are starting to get weird. And I don't think that I'm the only one. In the early 1990s, the US military, the US Army War College to be precise, which is an institution that tends to be ahead of the curve in these things, it's worth noting, came up with a term to describe the geopolitical reality of the post-Cold War world. And it's an acronym, and the acronym is VUCA. And VUCA stands for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. And I've been keeping tabs, and all four words have come up today in presentations, right? I am seeing VUCA in the news, and I am hearing my clients and my clients' users express this, that people are having a hard time understanding how things are fitting together, increasingly. To make it explicit, VUCA is when a movement that starts in a social network, in a matter of 3 weeks, topples a dictatorship that has been in power for 30 years. VUCA is when our appliances start attacking us, and we have no idea what it is. Brexit is a sign of VUCA. The results of the US presidential election, which were unpredictable, are a sign of VUCA. It's important that we recognize that the products that we design are the mechanisms by which many people make sense of and interact with the world. And I think it's time that we start approaching that responsibility with greater conscientiousness. Information environments can either help open our minds and increase our understanding of each other and of the world, or they can trap us in filter walls. So I think that we need to do this stuff that we've been doing much more conscientiously. And in the rest of the presentation, I want to offer 3 perspectives that we can adopt to help us design information environments that better support wholeness over the long term. The first of these is the acknowledgement that all information environments have underlying semantic structures that underpin the experience. And this is true whether these structures have been designed or not. These structures create contexts that help people not only find and understand the information, but also to make sense of the fact that they are in a particular place. And the key thing here, the key realization for me, you know, obviously I'm talking about information architecture. That's what this is, right? The key realization for me is that structure changes more slowly than other parts of the environment. And I think I've known this for a long time, at least some level of my consciousness has been aware of it, but I only became it only became really tangible to me when I was working on the 4th edition of the Polar Bear book. Because one of my tasks in that project was going over the entire text and updating the examples. So I had to visit all these really old websites and then kind of follow up and see where they are today. And one that stood out for me was FedEx. Because FedEx, in 2006, when the 3rd edition had been written, had a look and feel that was kind of that time. Whereas today it has this more contemporary look and feel, right? And that's understandable because technology's changed, we have better typography, we have better screens, etc. But when I started looking at the categories of the site, the different language and all the structures, they were pretty similar. Like, you could recognize that place. If you were to draw an outline instead of looking at the screen, you'd know that it was the same place. So it's important that we recognize that that the different parts of information environments don't change at the same rate. And these aren't the only things in the world that do this. There are other things in the world that change at different rates. And in his book, are you all familiar with the book, How Buildings Learn? Yes, so Stuart Brand. He introduced this concept of shearing layers to explain how buildings change. So we're back to architecture, right? And what he said is, buildings are composed of these 6 layers. And the 6 layers change at different speeds. The base layer, site, changes more slowly. That's geological time, right? Like, if you want to change the earth, that takes a lot of effort and expense and energy. And the fastest changing layer at the top, we call stuff. And if you want an illustration of this, when we leave here today, I guarantee that the chairs are going to be picked up and moved around to a different configuration. Right? The chairs are stuff. The ground the building is sitting on is site. Site changes slowly, chairs can happen. You know, stuff can change very quickly. In a subsequent book called The Clock of the Long Now, Brand extended this model to cover more than just buildings, and he used it to explain how civilizations change. Much broader picture, right? And again, in this version of the model, the slower changing layers are at the bottom, the top are the faster changing layers, with the bottom being nature, which again, that's almost like geological time, and the top layer being fashion and art. If you think about that, fashion and art change all the time. As a matter of fact, that is, you know, their very nature, that is what they do. And in this version of the model, Brand makes an important point which I think we need to keep in mind, which is that the resilience of a civilization depends on how healthy the interaction is between the slow-moving layers and the fast-moving layers. It's not that one is better than the other, they are codependent. So fashion and art are where civilizations experiment with new ideas. And the ideas that are worthwhile, that are worth keeping around, kind of trickle their way down the layers and get reified into the civilization and become part of the slower moving layers. So that they become permanent parts of the civilization. I find this pace layer model incredibly useful and valuable. It explains a lot of things in the world. So as I did with the Schlossberg quote, I have shamelessly stolen it and adapted it to the sort of work that we're doing. And in this version of the base layer model, we start with purpose, which is why does our product or organization exist in the world? What vision is it trying to get across? That purpose gets expressed as a particular strategy. How is that going to be different from the other people who are trying to do the same thing? Right? How are we going to go to market? How are people going to find out about it? Those are all kind of strategic questions. Strategy gets expressed as governance and operations. This is how the organization shapes itself to bring this strategy to bear. Think of org structures, bylaws, processes, the way that we sell, we interact with our channels, how we interact with clients, etc. Structure is where we come into the picture, normal, right? We get told, well, you know, now we, structure is information architecture, that, right? So structure is where we come in and we get told, well, you know, express this purpose and strategy as some kind of thing that people will interact with. And then finally, that structure is expressed in what I call the form layer. And you can think of form as user interface. So visual design, interactions. And you may be wondering, well, why separate from form from structure? I mean, after all, you know, these two are not like these three, right? This is, you're talking digital stuff here, and you're talking management stuff here. The reason I separate structure from form, there's actually two reasons. The first is that, as I've told you, I've noticed that structure tends to change more slowly, as with the FedEx example. The second reason is that we are now in a world in which form gets experienced through multiple different means. So it's not one form that we're creating, right? We are experiencing these things through phone apps and voice UIs and websites. And all these things are going to have more coherence if they are informed by a structural layer that they share from. We tend to spend more time talking about form than we know about structure in design. And there's good reasons for that. Form is really attractive. This is the stuff that you can print out and show to executives, and then you will all over. Executives don't like conceptual models. But it's important to recognize that structure is powerful. The further down the stack you go, the more powerful the element you're dealing with is. because these things change more slowly than you can stick around. And as with Brad's model, there is resilience in thinking about this holistically. You know, not separating from structure and governance, but thinking about how they interrelate. So that when we do research, as we heard in the previous panel was all about this. I don't know if you are there. You're seeing it map that way. There was this talk, I think it was Greg that said, our organization is shaped like our website, right? That's an example in which the stuff happening in this layer kind of is going down the stacks and becoming ratified. As an org chart, there's power in it. So this is a model that we've been using at FutureGraph. I personally find it useful in understanding what I'm doing. You know, when I have a new engagement, I ask myself, well, this problem that we're being tasked with delivering, what layer is this happening, right? And there are cases where we are brought in here, but we recognize that there is a problem happening here. And how do you transition that conversation is very important. So that's the first perspective, structure. Let's go on now to the second perspective. The second perspective is that the things that we design do not exist on their own. They create and participate in systems. And it's important that we recognize that. The Uber app in your phone is not just the Uber app. When you talk about the design of the design of the Uber app is actually meaningless without the fact that the understanding that Uber is a marketplace. There is an Uber passenger app, and there is an Uber driver, and there is software that bridges those two and that matches supply and demand. Uber is a system, it's not a set of independent apps. So what is a system? It's a set of elements that are interconnected or interdependent in such a way that they form a complex whole. And the most tangible example of a system is your body. So think of your body, right? You have all these organs, and these organs have different functions, but they all work in concert. And they work in concert for a particular purpose, which is to keep you alive. And the system has a bunch of feedback mechanisms, so that if you start, your energy starts flagging, you start feeling sleepy, or hungry, or thirsty, or what have you. Should those mechanisms fail, you could be in deep trouble, right? The study of systems is not new. This has been around for a while. We have ways of diagramming systems. But understanding systems somehow is challenging to us. And I find people kind of shy away from talking about systems. And my personal take on this is that we have issues with systems as practitioners. And the reason we have issues with systems is that understanding systems requires that we look at things holistically and intuitively. And these are skills that have atrophied after 300 years of reductionist thinking. We are not good at looking at the big picture. We are not good at tackling complexity. Our tendency, our impulse, the way that we've been educated is to break things down into smaller things that we can understand. And kind of look beyond this broader, scary hole of how things work together. We want fast and easy answers. We want someone to blame when things go wrong. And the result of this is that we have this kind of cultural blindness to systems. Is anyone here from Wells Fargo? I can speak freely. you may have heard in the news, Wells Fargo, the US's third largest bank, has been involved in this incredible scandal around a fraud that happened. And I'll give you a Cliff Notes version of it. Bank personnel sold 2 million accounts to existing customers who had not requested them. And when pressed on an explanation for this, the management of the bank blamed individual employees for the problem. But when people started pulling back what happened, you know, the management had incentivized people very strongly to sell new accounts, right? And this is a systemic issue. And saying, no, this is a problem with just a few bad apples is kind of our normal reaction to this sort of thing. It's like shy away from this, this system that we have created and interrupt the questions. So to bring it back to an example closer to our field, believe it or not, iTunes used to be simple. As a matter of fact, in the book Subject to Change that our friends at Adaptive Path wrote, it's used as an example, you know, the iTunes iPod ecosystem is used as an example of a well-designed system. And what's happened is Apple's media ecosystem has become much more complex in the intervening 13 years or whatever it's been, but the formal layer, the user interface part of it, has not adapted quickly enough to those systemic needs. And the result is that now it's being tasked with doing all these things that it doesn't do efficiently or elegantly. And it hasn't, my sense, again, I don't know the people who work on this, but my sense is that it has not been approached as a systemic design challenge. So what can we do about it? One way is to try to map out the elements and relationships in the system. It's a way to start. And there have been folks who have spoken before being here today. Kate was one. And Amy also showed a systems map, right? So there are ways of mapping these things out. Instead of belaboring this, I'm going to point you to a Medium post that Christina Watney published earlier this week on five different ways that you can map systems, and it's fabulous. And I would recommend that everyone go off and read this. You can, you probably can read it from where you're sitting, so come to me after the talk and I'll give you the URL. So, systems. Let's go now to the third perspective. The third perspective is that these systems that we're designing don't stand still. They are not static. They must keep growing and adapting and keep working as the conditions that brought them to life and that sustained them keep changing around them. As we saw with the example in iTunes, the media ecology around iTunes is very different today than it was in 2003, right? And we need to look to make our systems sustainable. And when I talk about sustainability, I'm talking about the sustainability of the system itself, without betraying its purpose. So we talked about this purpose layer, right? So the system should evolve without betraying its purpose. And it should also evolve without betraying its social context, the context that it exists in. So it needs to be sustainable in all three realms. And this maps very nicely to the three pillars of sustainable development, which were defined in the 2005 World Summit for Sustainable Development, which was, up to then, the largest gathering of global leaders up to that time. And these are three areas that they said that organizations needed to focus on if they wanted to have sustainable businesses that lie for the long term. And I think that all three of them apply to what we do. And I'm going to touch on those really quickly. So let's start with the easiest one, which is the economic pillar. So the economic pillar has two components. The first is the financial viability of the information environment that you're working in. Right? So the thing that you're making needs to pay for itself. It needs to be clear that there's going to be enough resources coming in to cover the resources that it's taking to keep the thing running. There's a broader economic concern, which is we need to ensure, or to the best of our abilities, work to try to make it so that these information environments are not increasing economic inequality and creating a world of haves and have-nots. So there is this concern for the environment itself and for the broader context. The second pillar is the social pillar. And in this one, I think we need to acknowledge that the things that we make must exist within a society. And in some cases, they also create societies. I don't know if you saw it, but earlier this week, Mark Zuckerberg posted this very interesting and lengthy pseudo-manifesto on what Facebook is trying to do to ensure that they're a viable community going forward. Right? So there's this acknowledgement that we're creating a kind of society. And the note I'll make here is that I think that information environments that are supported by advertising-based models have issues with them. Or at least I have issues with them. Because advertising is a practice that drives us to consume more. It's by definition a creation of demand, right? So it drives you to consume more, and it does so by dividing us in ever narrower demographic segments, so that we try to find, you know, this thing where the ideal is to advertise something that is interesting to me as an individual, right? And the issue that I have with this, and I know a lot of folks who work in advertising, I think it's a respectable thing. I think that connecting people with the things that they love is respectable. The reason I have issues with this is that I think that we are entering a time when we have to look to consume less and to find more things in common rather than focus on the things that divide us. The third pillar is the ecological pillar. And this one is a little trickier because this one requires kind of thinking metaphorically. But I'm going to name check here the media theorist Neil Postman, who in the 70s wrote about how information exists in what he called semantic environments. And he equated semantic environments with physical environments. And he said that if physical environments have a purpose of sustaining life, semantic environments, in our case information environments, have a purpose of sustaining meaning. And that just as physical environments can become polluted, information or semantic environments can also become polluted. And they become polluted when we start using words in ways that change their meaning. And they start becoming polluted when we introduce categorization schemes that change the way that the environment's purposes are served. Right? And we are seeing this play out in the news, ironically, in this concept of fake news, which we now hear about all the time. What is fake news? Fake news is we are used to consuming our news in this medium, and all of a sudden what we're getting is not news. It's something else, right? So that environment has become polluted. So we need to look to make our environments as ecologically sound as possible. And I'm not talking about physical ecology, I'm talking about information ecology. So the three pillars, social, economical, and ecological. Businesses that want to be sustainable report on all three of these. They are not just measured on economic success. They are measured on how they're doing on all three of them. Before I leave the subject, I need to note that just as physical environments have non-renewable resources, information environments have non-renewable resources as well, at least one. And that is the attention of the people who are interacting with these. Alan Cooper this morning talked about information as a form of capital. And I think that is one metaphor to use, is one way of looking at it. I prefer thinking of it as a resource because it's exhaustible. You can't really trade it away, right? And I think that we need to ask ourselves if the attention that we're asking our users to pay our environment, think of that metaphor. Are you paying attention, right? So the attention that our users are paying us to engage in our environments, we need to ask what they are getting in return. Are they becoming better citizens, better parents, better co-workers? Or are they merely, you know, getting dopamine hits so that we can show them more things to buy? So let's recap. Information is transforming our ways of being in the world in significant ways. We are in the process of replacing stable and long-lived contexts with highly malleable ones. And we need to aim for their viability. Alan Cooper this morning, I couldn't have asked for a better opening for him. He said, we need to look to be better ancestors. Right? This is what we're talking about. We're talking about being better ancestors with the understanding that these things that we're making are changing the world in considerable ways. We have talked about three ways, three perspectives we can adopt to do that. So design, as it has been traditionally practiced, at least for the last 100 odd years, with its hero designers and its focus on individual artifacts, in my opinion, is ill-suited for this task. It is incompatible with a world characterized with volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. At FutureCraft, we believe that designers are being called on to show the way towards a more complete utilization of the existing knowledge out there that is in everyone, in our users, in our clients, in our fellow designers, so that we can produce more comprehensive and sustainable solutions to these gnarly problems. As designers, we need to adopt a more holistic, systemic, and compassionate perspective. It is more thoughtful about the categorization schemes that we're imposing on the world. This requires that we see clearly the problems in front of us and try to reduce our own filters, right? It requires that we restrain our egos, put our egos on the back seat, and try to understand and see clearly so that we can act clearly. This would allow us to move towards a co-creative design practice, a practice that integrates the design skills of everyone who is going to be living with and living in these information environments that we create. Only by working together can we transcend the huge challenges that we currently face. This is a thought that is articulated beautifully in a quote by Christopher Alexander, which is my parting thought to you. He said, making wholeness heals the maker. And that is my parting wish for you all as we head back home for the rest of the weekend. That we find a way to heal ourselves and our societies through this craft of ours, through design. Okay? We are all stakeholders in the design of a more viable future. Thank you.